Well, since it got so quiet, we are going to start the evening with a public hearing on our first report. Our CFO, Darren Rice, is going to present information, and then if anybody would like to make a comment, if you'll come to the podium and state your name and make your comments, and if you'll keep them to a couple minutes, we'd appreciate that. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Darren Rice.
Thank you. Good evening, President Husbands, members of the board, and Dr. Stockton. It is my pleasure to present the School Financial Integrity Rating System of Texas Annual Financial Management Report. The state school financial accountability rating system, known as School Financial Integrity Rating System of Texas, or FIRST, ensures that Texas public schools are held accountable for the quality of their financial management practices and that they improve on those practices. The system is designed to encourage Texas public schools to better manage their financial resources, to provide the maximum allocation possible for direct instructional purposes. Several new indicators are more easily recognized and interpreted by both public and financial industry. The School First rating is based upon an analysis of staff and student data reported for the 2014-2015 school year and budgetary and actual financial data for the fiscal year ended August 31st, 2015. The School First rating system rated the district based on scores received from 15 separate performance indicators. Each performance indicator was designed to assess the quality of the financial management of the district's resources. Indicators 1 through 5 are strictly pass-fail. If you fail any one of these indicators, you fail the first report. Indicators 6 through 15 are worth up to 10 points each for a maximum score of 100. The School First Accountability Rating System assigns four possible financial accountability ratings to Texas School District. A is superior, that's 70 to 100 points. B is above standard, that's 50 to 69 points. C is met standard, 31 to 49 points. And F, substandard achievement, is less than 31 points. Conroe Independent School District received a rating of A, which is superior. We scored 94 out of 100 possible points. The superior rating is the state's highest, demonstrating the quality of Conroe ISD's financial management and reporting system. Now we'll go through each one of the 15 indicators. Indicator 1, was the complete annual financial report, or AFR, and data submitted to the TEA within 30 days of the January 28th deadline for the district's fiscal year end date, August 31st. And yes, our AFR was reported timely. Question number 2 has actual two indicators within this one. And 2A, was there an unmodified opinion in the AFR on the financial statements as a whole? Our answer is yes. 2B, did the external independent auditor report that the AFR was free of any instances of material weaknesses in internal controls over financial reporting and compliance for local, state, and federal funds? And our answer is yes also. Indicator 3, was the school district in compliance with the payment payment terms of all debt agreements at fiscal year end? Yes, we paid our bills on time. Indicator 4, did the school district make timely payments to the teacher retirement system, Texas Workforce Commission, Internal Revenue Service, and other government agencies? Yes. Indicator 5, was the total unrestricted net asset balance in the governmental activities column in the statement of net assets greater than zero? Yes, our balance was $42.7 million. So now we'll start with the indicators that assign points to each one. Indicator number 6, was the number of days of cash on hand and current investments in the general fund for the school district sufficient to cover operating expenditures, excluding facilities acquisition and construction? Yes, we had 78.9 days of cash on hand. However, we received only 8 of 10 points. And after I talk about indicator number 7, I'll have a quick statement to make on these. Indicator number 7, was the measure of current assets to current liabilities ratio for the school district sufficient to cover short-term debt? Our answer is yes. Our current ratio is 2.14. We received 6 out of 10 possible points on this indicator. To receive 10 points, the current ratio must have been 3.0. So just a quick comment on this. You know, working with the board's investment committee, we identified $50 million of our general fund fund balance that we could invest for a longer duration, thus earning us more interest money. We feel that this strategy is a more efficient use of our assets, and it put us in a stronger financial position than what indicators number 6 and number 7 give us. So we like that strategy. Indicator 8, was the ratio of long-term liabilities to total assets for the school district sufficient to support long-term solvency? If this school district's change of students in membership over 5 years was 10% or more, then the school district passes this indicator. And our answer is yes, our membership increased to 10.4%. We received all points. Number 9, did the school district's general fund revenues equal or exceed expenditures? And our answer is yes. Indicator 10, was the debt service coverage ratio sufficient to meet the required debt service? Yes, our ratio was 1.7378, and we received 10 out of 10 possible points, had to be greater than or equal to 1.2. Indicator 11, was the school district's administrative cost ratio equal or less than the threshold ratio? Our answer is yes. The acceptable administrative cost ratio is less than or equal to 0.0855. Our ratio was 0.0383. So as you see, we run a lean administration office. Number 12, did the school district not have a 15% decline in the students to staff ratio over 3 years? Total enrollment to total staff. If the student enrollment did not decrease, the school district will automatically pass this indicator. And yes, our enrollment increased by 2,429 students over the 3 years shown. Number 13, did the comparison of PEAMS data to like information in the AFR result in an aggregate variance of less than 3% of all expenditures by function? Our answer is yes, we had 0% variance. Number 14, did the external independent auditor indicate that the AFR was free of any instances of material noncompliance for grants, contracts, and laws related to local, state, or federal funds? Our answer is yes, we had no instances of material noncompliance. And the last indicator, did the school district not receive an adjusted repayment schedule for more than one fiscal year for an overallocation of foundation school program funds as a result of a financial hardship? Our answer is yes, we did not receive an adjusted repayment. The first report, along with the additional required disclosures that includes the superintendent's contract and the school first annual financial management report, can be located on the district's transparency website at the link listed below. And thank you.
Okay, at this time, Mr. Rice is done with his presentation. If anyone has a comment, please come to the podium and state your name and make your comments. Okay, seeing no movement whatsoever, we're going to close the public hearing and turn it over to Mr. Husbands. Thank you.
Call this meeting of the Conroe Independent School District Board of Trustees to order. Let a record show that a quorum of members is present. The meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code Chapter 551. It is 6:08. If you will, by the way, welcome to October board meeting of CISD. We're proud you're here. If you would, stand with me, and Mr. Kidd will lead us in the invocation, and Mrs. Bush in the pledges, if you will.
If you would like to join me, please bow your heads with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for your grace. Thank you for loving us. Dear God, just thank you for the freedoms we enjoy, the freedom to vote and just be with this country during this election season. Dear Lord, thank you for those in this room and for their hearts for service of your children. And we just ask for your guidance and your direction so that we may glorify you in our decisions. Be with us tonight in how we conduct our business. And again, just to guide and direct us in the ways that would be pleasing to you. Thank you. Lord, we ask for protection of our students, our teachers, our staff, our administrators. And just in this fall time, Lord, just be with each and every one of them. And just help us have a good and productive meeting. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. Texas Rock.
And the Texas Pledge?
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kidd and Mrs. Bush. Item 2A, do we have anybody signed up for citizens participation?
Yes, sir.
The next 30 minutes has been designated for public participation by patrons who have signed up to address the board in accordance with board policy BED. Please remember the board may not discuss or act upon any issues that are not posted on our agenda. The board has adopted complaint policies that are designed to secure at the lowest administrative level a prompt and equitable resolution of complaints and concerns. These policies provide that if a resolution cannot be reached administratively, the person may appeal the administrative decision to the board as a properly posted agenda item. Copies of the district's complaint policies can be found on the district's website. Those who have registered to address the board will be limited to 5 minutes for their presentation. Delegations of five or more than five must appoint all and a representative to present their views to the board. Ms. Godfrey, please call the first person who has signed up to address the board.
Nanette Prost. Good evening. I have lived in the southeast corner of Montgomery County in the Oak Ridge Feeder in the Spring Trails neighborhood for the past 13 years. I have four children that attend Conroe High Schools in 9th, 7th, 5th, and 3rd grades. My oldest is a freshman at Oak Ridge High School. He will be a junior the year that the Grand Oaks High School opens. I am here to encourage you to allow him to attend the new high school. For years, our family plan included our oldest sons attending high school together. If you force my oldest to remain at Oak Ridge, my two oldest children will never be able to attend the same high school, which is really sad. I know that there will be an option for a variance for my second child to attend Oak Ridge, but this will require him to make all new friends, and then 2 years down the road when my next child is ready for high school, I will be in the same predicament and he will have to make new friends again at Grand Oaks, so this is not an option for our family. When College Park High School was opened, you allowed juniors the choice if they would like to attend the new school. I would like you to also give us that choice. When I spoke to one of you in the spring about this issue, you mentioned that you didn't think that went well because a lot of students that committed to College Park changed their minds and you feared that we would do the same. Let me make it clear that we will not do the same. College Park and the Woodlands are very close geographically to each other. If I had a student at one and he or she asked me to attend the other, I would be willing to make an exception for them because it would only add a few minutes to my driving time. This is not at all the case with Oak Ridge and the new Grand Oaks High School. It takes me an hour round trip to get to Oak Ridge to get my child there. It would only take me 10 minutes to get to the new high school. I anticipate that the traffic disaster that is Oak Ridge North will not get fixed in the next couple of years, and add that to the current plan to do major road work on Rayford Road, and that time is likely to go up and not down. We've lived through construction of the Grand Parkway, and we know that road work can exponentially increase our commute time. My children attend a before school seminary program, and there are no buses available to those who go to seminary. So just sticking him on a bus is not a solution for us either. Having two students at two high schools for 2 years will create a large amount of unnecessary stress on our family. I have talked to many of my friends who have children spaced like I do, and they feel the same way. As it stands now, when I have both of my two oldest in high school, but at two different schools, if they want to attend extracurricular activities that are after school, I will have to limit the activities they can participate in because I will be too busy trying to manage my other children's schedule and needs. As it is now, I cannot get to Oak Ridge after school to pick up my oldest if he wants to stay because my youngest will be left at home without adult supervision for too long while I make the lengthy drive. He doesn't even get home in time to go over to Oak Ridge. When I spoke with one of the members of the school board in the spring, they suggested a couple of reasons why they thought that students wouldn't want to move. One reason was given that the sports programs wouldn't be as good. I understand this reasoning and see that it affects some students. The problem with this logic is that it affects the minority of the students, and yet the majority of the students are forced to accommodate them. There are many students, probably the majority, that do not play varsity sports and so wouldn't be affected by the opening of a new high school. It seems unfair to cause hardships on their families to accommodate the minority of the students in sports. Another reason given to keep the juniors at Oak Ridge was the difficulty with hiring. I find this an unbelievable argument. First off, there are the same number of students in the school district no matter what school they attend. The same number of teachers will have to be hired to teach the same number of students no matter if they are at Oak Ridge or Grand Oaks. Also, if you decide to offer an unusual language at Grand Oaks, like Chinese, once you hire the teacher, you will have to fill their teaching schedule with classes, so there will be space to offer all levels of that class. If you force juniors to stay at Oak Ridge, you will have to provide buses for 2 years to all of the neighborhoods in the Grand Oaks area. That is a lot of redundancy in busing, and I would think that would be an expensive undertaking for Conroe ISD. If you allow juniors to go to Grand Oaks, you will only have to bear that expense for 1 year while the seniors are still at Oak Ridge. My son's freshman class currently has 1,169 students in it. High school enrollment in our area is only going to continue to climb. It is time to stop putting Band-Aids on the overcrowding of our high school and immediately take the steps to provide for the future of our kids. The benefits are clear. Immediately opening Grand Oaks to all zoned high school students helps our kids. It is better for our families and provides an immediate solution to overcrowding, traffic, and the additional expense of moving kids all the way to Oak Ridge. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Adam Frost.
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Adam Frost. I'm a freshman at Oak Ridge High School. In September of 2018, Grand Oaks High School opens, I will be a junior and my brother Michael will be a freshman. I understand that the board has decided to prevent me and my friends from attending Grand Oaks High School, and I am here to encourage you to allow me, my juniors or seniors who wish to attend Grand Oaks immediately when it opens. As you know, Oak Ridge is very crowded, with many students in my freshman class. Generally, decent parking options are unavailable except for a lucky few, and traffic is a nightmare. It can take 30 minutes for me to get from Spring Trails to the school in the morning. I have 4 points I would like to ask you to consider for myself and my many other students and families who would be at disadvantage by not being able to attend Grand Oaks. First, an important part of my high school experience is social. Being with friends, many of which have been in school together for years. I've lived in Spring Trails for 13 years, I was a kindergarten in the very first class of Broadway Elementary. For the most part, I've been in the same classes with the same friends for years, even in middle school and junior high. Our schools were located right next to each other, making before and after school activities easy to coordinate. Even if you do not allow juniors and seniors to attend Grand Oaks, the first time I'll be separated from my younger friends by a 5-minute drive. These kids I've grown up for with my entire life. This will dramatically decrease the high school experience for many kids like me. Second, for families like mine with multiple kids in high school, the process of getting us all to school will be unreasonably difficult. We'll be divided for school activities, events, school functions. Asking my mother to manage the situation when she is already busy with 4 kids seems unfair. Since my brother is 2 years behind me in school, we will also be separated during our entire high school experience. Third, I have heard some people say that kids at Grand Oaks would lose out on participating in sports. This is backwards. Kids who really want to stay with Oak Ridge Sports can stay. For others like me, probably, and most other kids, sports are not the focus of our entire student life. Even then, with 2 schools, more kids, not less, should be able to participate in sports that are offered. Finally, I have heard the arguments that there may not be enough teachers. Maybe this is an issue I don't understand, but currently, 8 of the same course offered at Oak Ridge. Why can't like 2 of these be moved to Grand Oaks? We still have over a year to plan this, and it seems like the staffing in the new school with current and new teachers should be well within the ability of the school board. Thank you for giving me a chance to speak tonight. I hope you will remember the importance of this decision to me and so many kids and families just like me. Thank you.
Thank you, young man.
Thank you, Adam.
Very good. I've had no request to remove any items from the consent agenda, so I will now entertain a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda.
I moved.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All opposed, like so. Very much. Item 4A, Texas Accountability Summary, SAT, ACT Advanced Placement TELPASS results for 2016. Dr. Stockton.
Okay, I'll ask Dr. Null to come and present that report.
All right. Good evening, President Husbands, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. Tonight is always.
Excuse me. Dr. Null,
yes,
one
sir?
Second, please.
Absolutely.
I failed to recognize Mr. Shipps in the audience tonight. Would you stand just a minute?
Yes, sir.
In that consent agenda, I would like to announce that you're looking at the next, the new director of CTE. And we congratulate you, sir, and I just wanted to make a point. I'm sorry to interrupt.
That's okay. Absolutely. Well, appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight to share with you what we lovingly call our ABC report. All the different acronyms that we could throw into one PowerPoint presentation, that's what you will see this evening. I get the pleasure of presenting this information, but there's a lot of hard work that goes into making this available. And what I will share tonight is just a snippet of what is compiled and put together. There's almost a 100-page document that is available to all online, and it'll be posted tonight after the meeting that anyone can go see. And we've tried to pull out some highlights tonight to share with you this evening. As I said, this doesn't happen without a lot of hard work. And so I'd just like to take a second here to recognize those that have really helped. And Dr. Hines has spent many years giving this report and created such a fabulous template, so we thank him. Certainly Mr. Caker and Dr. Phillips from the Assistant Superintendent's offices, and Ms. Winkler as well. And then I want to introduce some folks that aren't always with us at the board meeting, so we'll ask them to stand as we go. Ms. Darren Carlisle, our coordinator of bilingual and ESL, is here. Denise Cipolla, our coordinator of guidance and counseling. Debbie McNeely, our coordinator for advanced academic programs. Dr. Julie English, our director of assessment and evaluation. Mr. Greg Shipp, our director of career and technical education. Make my PowerPoint obsolete there, Mr. Shipp. Ms. Veronica Martin Perkins is our college readiness specialist, and she is primarily responsible for the compilation of the work that we'll see tonight. So we just want to thank all of them for their hard work. And my secretary, Isabel Lopez, is not here, but she's fantastic. And then this presentation would not look nearly as great as it looks without her hard work. So we thank all of them. And then beyond that, I think we'd be remiss if we didn't stop to celebrate, because I'm going to share a lot of good news tonight. And it's a privilege for me to get to do that. But we get to do this, and we all get to compile this because of what happens on campuses. And I know we have some campus personnel here today, and I'd just like for them to stand up, all campus folks to stand up so we can celebrate you, because we're going to share a great story here. So thank y'all very much. So we do have quite a few slides, and I'm going to try to keep moving. If you have questions, absolutely, we can slow down and talk further into any specifics that you have, but we'll try to keep it moving. We start with our accountability summary from the state. All districts and campuses have a front page accountability summary that looks similar to this. You see up here at the top, our accountability rating is met standard. And then we're going to break down further in these future slides each of these additional areas that are on the accountability summary. And we'll start with index one. That's student achievement. So this is the basic: how well do our students do on the test in which they take, the EOCs, the STAR exams? What, you know, do they pass the test or not? And this is the only of the four indexes that we'll talk about that is truly a percentage score. The rest are a complicated combination of points, and the total, or the best score, is not always 100. This is the one place that is truly a percentage. And so you'll see our index one score at 85. The state's target score for us is a 60, and you can see there the state's score as well. Index two is student progress. And, you know, we've been talking about adding value for many years in Conroe ISD, and the state added this piece to our accountability system a few years ago. But it measures student growth independent of overall achievement. And you gain 1 point for each student that met expected growth, 2 points if a student exceeded that expected growth. So that's independent of passing. You may have a student that still didn't pass but made growth, and we earn a point. We have students that passed the test but maybe didn't get full growth, so we may not have gotten a point. So you see index two, we're 42, state 40, and the target is 22. Index three is closing the performance gap. So this measures our economically disadvantaged students, and then our two race and ethnicity student groups that are our lowest performing in the previous year, to see how they are doing, if they're making advancement and raising their scores. It's the same measure, 1 point and 2 points, that we can receive for students that for satisfactory and advanced performance. And you can see that we are at 46, state's at 39, and the target was 28. Index four, as you can see from all the words on the screen, is the most complicated, but it's also very important. And this measures how well prepared our students will be when they leave high school for whatever it is that they encounter next. If it's going to the workforce, if it's going to trade school, college, whatever it is that they want to move on to. You see the four criteria that go into this score: STAR scores, and that's from elementary on up. The STAR scores, the students that meet Final level two on two or more exams, they would earn points here. And then for the high schools only, you get a graduation score based on a graduation rate, graduation plan score, those students that are taking the more rigorous graduation plans, which that's a slide that I'll share later to show you how we're doing there. And then also the post-secondary readiness component, which is basically, are students college ready by testing, which is the TSI, SAT, or ACT, or those students that have completed and received credit in two advanced or dual credit courses, or they're enrolled in a CTE coherent sequence, meaning they're in a program, multiple courses in a row in the same field of study. Our post-secondary readiness score is 80, 75 for the state, and the target score was 60. Now, system safeguards are a reporting system that disaggregate the data by test and by demographic group. So we have multiple measures of safeguards, and you could see we had 84 different measures, and 77 of those met the standards, so we're at 92%. You get our target areas, our special education performance and reading, math, writing, science, and social studies, and our ELL performance in writing and social studies. And as we've spoken of previously, we understand these are our areas that we're working on. I would also point out that all of our comparison districts that we like to benchmark ourselves to, theirs look exactly this way. It's a challenge that we're all working on right now. Now, district distinctions, as we talked about, we were met standard as a district, and the district is only eligible for one distinction. It's in through post-secondary readiness. We would need to achieve 70% of the measures in order to get a district distinction. And you can see for us, we earned 33% of those measures. You can see how we compare. It's a lofty standard to get there, and while we are a ways off, we continue to work towards that. Now, our campus distinctions, every campus is eligible to earn distinctions on their own right. They are compared. Each campus is put into a group of 40 schools that demographically are like them, should be very similar by student population, size, socioeconomics, programs. It should be fairly similar in that group of 40. Their goal, each campus's goal, is to compete with those schools that are like them, and they want to come out in the top quarter of that group of 40 in all of the measures. And if you land in the top quarter, so you're in the top 10 of that 40 bunch, then you can earn a distinction. And they can earn distinction in student progress or closing the achievement gaps. That's at index 2 and 3, post-secondary readiness, and then in the academic areas of language arts, mathematics, social studies, and science. So when you look at all of our districts and all of the possible distinctions that they could have earned, we earned 38% of those distinctions, which is great. You know, one thing you would note when you look at this, you'll see CIFAIR at 43%. There's a reason that we look at that in a lot of different ways, because we see 43% here for them and 38% for us, but if you went back and looked at those four index scores for us as compared to CIFAIR, in index 2 and 3 we had the same score, but in index 1 and 4 we outperformed them in those index. So it's important that you look at a lot of different angles, and so you know exactly what you're looking for. Now, each year we're asked to share our TailPass information, and sometimes this can be a little confusing, and when we throw some big charts up here with numbers, but we talk about TailPass, and we want to see how our English language learners are progressing towards English proficiency, okay? And there's four language domains, listening, speaking, reading, and writing, and then our four proficiency levels, basically beginning, which is little or no English ability, to all the way to advanced high, meaning they're basically on grade level and are able to function in an English-speaking classroom without much intervention at all. Now, this is the chart that we show, and it gets, I'm not sure what we point out here, to be honest with you, but we're asked to show this, so we do. But we're going to show you another slide that I think shows a better picture. But one thing you'll note here is that in that left-hand column moving forward, it decreases in number every year because our students advance out of the program. But students always enter the program every year, too, and they enter at all different levels. You know, we may have a lot of students come in pre-K, but some students come in 7th grade or 9th grade or throughout the process. One of the new slides that Ms. Carlisle put together for us this year, as she and I were talking last year, I said, well, how do we know if we're performing? Are we advancing students? That's our goal. Are we advancing levels? And so she put this together to really help paint a picture for us that you can see from 2 years ago to last year how we performed as far as advancing students at least one level during that school year. And overall, we're doing a nice job, and last year we did a little better than the year before, and that's our goal, to get better every year.
Dr. Noel, can you go back one slide?
I can.
So the number to the right of the grade is the number of English language learner students
in that group.
That are in that particular grade?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right? That's not a total of all students that speak English. I guess what I'm getting at is you may have had students, not in kindergarten obviously, mm-hmm. but in the other grades that have advanced out of
absolutely
being an ELL
absolutely
student that may at one time have been in.
Absolutely. And we've added a slide that I'm going to share with you
okay,
in a
I'm
moment
sorry.
To show you
I'm
exactly how they're doing
okay. That's
in the English.
Headed.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right.
So, like we said, Darren has shown us that we're making good progress on TELPASS, and that's a positive. Now, we've also talked in years past about our Spanish star scores. Mm-hmm. And you can see here the top graph is our scores. The bottom graph is the state scores. And really, within reason, we're very close. We know that we have an early exit model, so our denominator tends to get really small really quickly because we're trying to move kids out. And that's our goal. And so overall, we're performing well. But the big question, which you were just alluding to, Mr. Sanders, is, so when they move out, how are they doing?
Right.
Yeah. Because that's the bottom line is they can't graduate from high school unless they pass an EOC, and the EOCs are all in English.
Right.
So
right.
Are we getting that job done? And when a student exits ESL services, they are required to be monitored by our ESL bilingual department for 2 years. So we have a monitor 1 year and a monitor 2 year. And so we continue to really watch them and make sure they are performing well. We look at their academic progress in the classes, but also on state exams. So what you see here is our students that are monitor year one students, how they performed on the STAR test that first year out. And this would be taking the English test. And you can see they are really performing strong.
Phenomenal.
Yeah, they absolutely are doing a great job. Almost all the scores are within just a fraction of our overall score, you know, within just a point or two. I would note that you'll see a little bit of variance, and I'm going to go to monitor year two slide here in a second. And down when you get to the EOC scores, English 1, English 2, the number of students in those groups are like 10 or 11, so you see some fluctuation pretty big in percentage. So here's the year two, how our year two students are doing. So you see a little more fluctuation. I would tell you the English 2 test is the hardest of all the EOCs. It's hard for any student. And that writing component, there is a writing component on the English 2, and that's, as you would expect, one of the last skills to emerge for our students. But overall, you can see, and this was really great work by Ms. Carlisle and her team. Yes, sir.
It's performance satisfactory. How do we define satisfactory? They make a 50 above 100.
It's the state standard, whatever the state passing standard is on each test. It's different on each test. We're on level two now of the state's accountability standard. So this would be the same passing standard for all students.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a different. It's a different number for every test. It's not a set number from the state.
I noticed seventh grade math seems to be, if you look at monitor one and monitor
yes.
two, seventh grade math is
it's tough.
Difficult.
It is. It is. And it's difficult for
everyone.
Yes. And if you've seen a math test lately, different from when we were in school, it's a reading test first.
Yes,
you know, you first must be able to really decipher the reading. They're all word problems today. So if you can't decipher the reading fully, it's hard to get the math right. So I think we see some of that in there, still working through the language. Academic vocabulary is a big push for all of our students, honestly. English language learners especially, but all of our students, it's important that we continue to work on that. Dr. Stockton often talks about if he had one slide that he could share, this would be the slide. And because this is a culmination of work from everybody, everybody that's in this room, everybody that's out there driving buses and working with kids at school, and every single one of us play a role in the graduation rate trend. And to be at 95.7, and we believe that's the highest ever, that maybe we've ever been, is really incredible. And that means that students are finding what they're looking for at school. There's adults that love and care for them and make them feel welcome and are preparing them to be successful. So the one we're most proud of right there. Our data goes back a year to be a little more specific, but to look at our dropout rate and continuers. And you can see the previous year we were at 94.7. But you see 2.9% of students that continue, and that number is important, because just because they don't meet the state's timeline to be considered a graduate on this chart doesn't mean that we give up. We keep going to get them, we keep pulling them back, because it makes a difference in their life. We can get those kids to graduate. It makes a big difference. So while you see 94.7, we're very hopeful that the 2.9 end up being graduates as well. Now, graduation plans, this is one of those slides that's changing. We've been talking about it for a few years now with the new House Bill 5 and the new graduation plans. And so you can see the previous years, and then our new year, we've changed the color scheme. And really, what you want to look at here is the yellow represents the minimum graduation plan. So our goal is to continue to shrink the yellow and increase the other colors. And we've been successful at doing that moving forward. What shows up there in that final column on the right is the red. That's that new foundations program that all of our juniors will be forced to be on, but we've given the opportunity for earlier classes to move to that plan if it's more beneficial for them. So you can see we did have over 2% of students take us up on that in last year's class. I think it'll be a little higher for this graduating class, and then will be fully transitioned for the future. SAT performance, once again, we perform very well as compared to the state and the nation. When you see this long-term trend of SAT, we do this because we like to compare where we are with the state and the nation. We have to remember that the test changes all the time. So This is not really an accurate reflection, because the test changed last year, and they sometimes will renorm scoring along the way too. So the 2007 score can't really compare equally to a 2015 score, but we can watch how we're performing with the state and the nation to make sure that we're continuing that. Our participation in SAT, we want more and more of our kids to take the test, and we've seen that increase over the years. National Merit Competition, this is a competition that's based on the PSAT. Actually, our students will take the PSAT tomorrow. It's a nationwide PSAT day tomorrow for our juniors. All juniors across the nation take the PSAT, and then it's broken down by each state. The top 1% of performers in each state earn the distinction of National Merit Scholar. These are the students that you'll meet next month. We always bring them in November, so you'll have a chance to meet our 27 students that are represented here next month when they come forward. One of the things, and we might mention it next month, but I want to mention it now because it's a big deal. Like I said, it's 1% of students from across the state. So every state has a different qualifying score to be a National Merit Scholar. You could live in a neighboring state and your qualifying score might be 212, and in Texas your qualifying score is 220. Okay, and so the Texas score is the seventh highest score in the nation. So when you meet those 27 students next month, they are truly an elite company, just fantastic students. Our ACT results, we're seeing more and more students take the ACT. It seems like it's gaining a lot of steam nationwide with colleges as well. We continue to perform well. Our score dipped a little this year, but the number that I'm most proud of is there at the bottom of the screen, 14% increase in test takers. Very significant. More and more students taking that test. And for whatever reason, sometimes students feel more comfortable attacking that test instead of the SAT. They just, it feels a little more like a test that they're used to taking. So they will take that one. The ACT has the subject area test, and you can see our trends there as well. ACT measures college readiness in their own way, and what they do is they look to see if you meet the standard in all four subject areas, and so you can see once again our performance, and with the addition, with the additional 14% of test takers, I think this might be expected a little bit. Not to mention, you know, last year's ACT performance was just kind of off the charts, as we've seen. So a little bit of renorming was probably to be expected. Advanced placement exams. This is a great slide. We all understand the benefits of advanced placement and what that can do for students as they move on to college. And you can see 9,386 tests taken last year by over 4,300 students. Numbers just continue to rise. I think students really understand the benefit of these advanced placement exams. You can see our mean score, the scale for advanced placements of 1 to 5, our mean score at a 2.87. And we often have students that might be enrolled in 6 or 7 AP exams. And so sometimes they'll focus in on, there's a 2-week window for advanced placement exams. So if you're taking 6 or 7, it may not be that you can truly study and prepare for those 7 exams all at once. But a lot of times our students will really focus on, say, the 4 that they know they're going to do well. But we still encourage them to take the test because there's benefit in sitting for the test. It's going to help them when they get to college. And so we still encourage them, even if they feel like, oh, I didn't have time to study because I was studying for this other one. We still encourage them to take the test, and we want them to do that. And we talk about, well, what are our top AP exams? I think 3 years ago we stood up here and mentioned human geography, and we said, watch out for human geography. It's really about to explode, and it has really exploded. 918 students taking human geography. The reason that this is significant is this is primarily a freshman-level course, meaning we have freshmen entering high school taking a college-level course and being overall very successful in it. And this gets them on the track to AP courses, to dual credit courses, where they feel like they can be successful and they understand the benefits of what that is. Another number on here that makes me proud is world history. That's the course that immediately follows human geo. So we're not losing a ton of them. You know, they're coming back and taking the next class. You know, they found success in the first one, and they're staying on the track. And so those are numbers that we're real proud of. And I think because those two numbers are so high, we will continue to see the rest of these numbers increase over time as these kids move through the system. Now, when you see AP numbers continue to grow up, you might think, well, are we cannibalizing our dual credit program for the sake of AP? And we can proudly say, absolutely not. What we're doing is we're getting more kids involved in both of these programs. We're fortunate to be a district that really really enjoys success in both of these programs. A lot of times you'll see districts that focus completely on AP or completely on dual credit, and they don't do a great job of finding the right place for every student. We've done that, and we've been very successful. You can see our enrollment here. Dual credit enrollment with Lone Star College. The numbers in black represent fall enrollments for this year. The red will be the courses that they'll take in the spring. These are very strong, and when you look at the chart here, it's incredible. You know, we have more than doubled over the last 4 years the number of students enrolled, or the number of enrollments courses being taken in dual credit. So you see that exploding, you see AP continue to increase. It tells you our campuses are doing a great job of seeking out students to get them into these courses. Represented on that chart are not only those academic, traditional English and history type courses, but we also have workforce programs that are dual credit that through Mr. Shipp's department. You can see welding. Phlebotomy we have a new section of phlebotomy, and this year that's going to be at the Woodlands High School. It's being taught on campus at the Woodlands High School, so students don't have to travel as far. But you can see multiple workforce programs, and this has been very successful at Hawk. They've really embraced this at Hawk and are getting more and more students in the dual credit workforce programs, and that's a positive. That's Mr. Shipp and Ms. Nicolini doing a great job there. We talked just a few weeks ago about those CTE certifications, so here they are for last year. Over 1,000 CTE certifications, and I'll not read you the entire list, but there are a few highlights here that I think are great. One of them is Serve Safe, you know, food handler certification. If they're going to go to work anywhere in the dining industry or hospitality, this helps our students get hired. You know, it's beneficial for restaurants because they earn points from the health department due to the number of their servers that have Serve Safe. So it's beneficial to the corporate world. It's really beneficial to our students because it gets them hired ahead of others that don't have that. So as all of these certifications do, it really gives them a leg up as they move on into the workforce. And we always talk to our students about, you know, what do they plan to do after high school? And we see those results when Dr. Stockton shares them with us at the assembly every year of how they feel. But we ask them where they headed, and you can see 53% say a four-year college. But more and more students are talking to us about two-year college. And oftentimes they're going to work full-time or part-time and attend a college. And that's where some of these CTE programs make a big difference and help finance that, help them work their way through it. And where our students headed, they're so fortunate to have, you know, numerous great universities right here within our region. A&M continues to be our number one. I knew there'd be somebody. Our number one school, but UT Austin, Sam Houston, just right down the road. So fortunate to have those schools, UTSA and University of Houston. But so many great schools that our students are able to go and not be too far away from home. Two events that we're real proud of here as I kind of wrap up tonight's presentation. Our college night was just last week. Well over 100 colleges were there. I was there as a parent. You know, I was in the hustle and bustle, and it was great. Walking around to all the tables and college representatives there, a lot of energy in the room. Like I said, well over 100 colleges. We estimated from – we don't do a turnstile attendance, but the estimate from – the parking lot crowd and of coming and going was over 3,500 attendees, so a great event. And then coming up on October 27th, we're back out at the Lone Star Convention Center for our Career Expo, and that continues to grow each year. This year we've really opened it up. We're going to allow other districts to be a part of that as well. The same thing that we do with the college fair. We think that will be beneficial for the businesses involved as well, just going to get more people in the room, which will help us fill more and more booths. Sometimes these companies come and they are trying to recruit people to go to work for them right now, and as soon as the student graduates. And sometimes they're sharing opportunities with the students about, look, if you will go and get this certification, or if you will go and get this technical training, or if you will go and get this degree, these are the jobs that we have in our company for you when you come back. And so it's just a great opportunity, and we would encourage you and invite you to come out on October 27th if you're available to do that. So I promise that was the short version, okay? But we get excited because it's a lot of good news and it's a lot of hard work that all of our people put in to make this happen. So if there are any questions, we're happy to entertain them or ask an expert to answer. Thank you.
Thank you. No.
Okay, the next item, the formerly improvement required plan for Austin Elementary and the target improvement plan for Sam Houston Elementary. I'm going to ask Dr. Phillips, Assistant Superintendent for Elementary Ed, to come up, and we're going to go to public hearing at this point, and Dr. Phillips will present some information, and then if anybody has a comment, you are welcome to come to the podium, state your name, and make your comment. So at this time, I'll turn it over to Dr. Phillips.
Thank you, President Husbands, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. Thank you for this opportunity to present for your approval the targeted improvement plans for Austin and Houston Elementary. And tonight we have quite a few representatives from Sam Houston Elementary. We have our principal, Christina Upshaw. And anybody from Houston Elementary, will you please stand? So we appreciate you coming to see us and supporting your school. Any representatives from Austin? We have Austin. Yay. Thank you so much. We appreciate the work we've done, too. So Dr. Nall did a great job of explaining the accountability system, so I won't dive into that too deeply. But just as a reminder, the accountability system is built on the four indices. Index one is all about student performance and how many students pass the test. Index two is all about student progress and how well do students progress year after year. Index three is all about closing performance gaps among student groups, and index four refers to post-secondary readiness. So in order to receive a MET standard rating, schools have to meet the state target on index one or index two, and they also have to receive the state target, have to meet the state target for index three and index four. If schools or districts do not meet this criteria, they receive an improvement required rating. And if they receive an improvement required rating, they go into a process called the Texas Accountability Intervention System, or TAISE process. And so I'm going to talk to you tonight about the schools that are currently in that process. So we have two schools that are a part of the TAISE process. You can see the state targets are listed up there. Index one for the state required is 60, index two a 32, index three a 28, and index four post-secondary readiness was a 12. And Austin Elementary knocked it out of the park this year. They exceeded all of the state targets. As a result of that, they've moved from improvement required to formally improvement required. So they're considered FIR. If they continue this upward trend and stay in meeting the state expectations for one more year, they'll start working their way out of the TAISE process. Houston Elementary did not meet the state target in two indices, index one and index two, but they did meet the requirement for index three and index four. So they're going to be entering the TAISE process this year. So what does that mean? Austin Elementary and Sam Houston are both under the TAISE process. They both have to assign a campus intervention team. This is a team of support staff from district, the professional service provider, and also the campus staff as well. They have to designate a district coordinator of school improvement, and in Conroe ISD, that's Shelley Winkler. They designate a professional service provider, and we have Houston's service provider here, Delise Lloyd. Is Delise still here? Mm-hmm. She's awesome. She's been working with us. We contract with Delise, brings a lot of talent and experience to us. We also have to identify members of the campus leadership team, and I'm assuming that some of them are here tonight that are helping develop the plan. And then Sam Houston will be participating in some training modules. Austin Elementary, this is the one difference. Austin Elementary does not have to participate in training it, although it is optional. And then the reason we're here tonight is both schools will need to develop a targeted improvement plan that needs to be approved by the board. Okay, so let's look at Austin's plan. They have stayed true to the course for 3 years. This plan has not changed much, and it's paying off in a big way for Austin. They've had the same three goals, and they've just modified their approach to the goals over the last few years. But their first goal is all students and student groups will be at 75% passing on the Reading Star, and they have really put a lot of emphasis on developing guided reading with rigor and fidelity. And so now they feel like they've made a lot of progress with teachers. They're bringing new teachers into the fold and continuing this plan. And then on top of that, they are introducing a new form of professional development that Shelley Winkler introduced to you a couple of months ago. But they're participating in something called instructional rounds. And that is an approach to professional development where teachers come in, they observe each other, they give each other feedback, and they refine their skills. So we're introducing that new element this year. Goal two is deals with the Writing Star, increasing the number of students passing writing, and they're going to continue to work on developing writers' workshop strategies, providing staff development, and again, including instructional rounds in the process. And their final goal is to work on that index two, which you'll remember is that each student makes progress from 1 year to the next. And for this, they're going to continue staff development for teachers, utilizing instructional rounds, but they're going to focus on the instruction that's happening during interventions and during enrichments. So that's the plan for Austin. Now, what's interesting is our Houston folks got together And the TASE process, I think, is really a good process for any school, but it teaches you how to really use your data, how to investigate and discover the root causes that are keeping you from success, and then develop a plan to address those. And so the Sam Houston plan is almost identical to the Austin plan. So we feel real good about it. It's worked for Austin, and we think Sam Houston's going to have a lot of success as well. So their goal one is 65% of all students will meet the standard on the Reading Star assessment. Again, their focus is on implementing guided reading with consistency and fidelity. We're using district coaches and campus coaches to help support them in that. Goal two addresses writing. Again, they're going to be focused on implementing writer's workshop with consistency and fidelity using coaches. And goal three is also targeting index two, that progress measure. And they're going to continue working on staff development that addresses interventions and enrichment during instruction. So that concludes the presentation.
Okay, at this time, if anybody would like to make a comment, please come to the podium and state your name and make your comments. Okay, seeing no takers, we will conclude our public hearing and turn it back over. Well, actually, at this time, we'll ask for approval from the board for the plans.
Very good. Do I have a motion and a second?
I move. I'll second.
A motion and a second to approve the plans. Any discussion, questions?
Just to Dr. Phillips, if you sure. would pull the slide up where you talked about consistency and fidelity
with Austin or with Houston.
I was in the process of asking for definition.
We were trying to answer the question.
I saw fidelity bonds, but I didn't.
Oh.
I think I understand what you mean.
Do you understand?
But I think I do. But
consistency is how often.
Correct.
And regularly.
Correct.
And fidelity is to the extent that it was designed to be.
Okay.
Okay.
Precisely. Clear that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's the way I was defining it.
Okay.
I needed my dictionary, but I didn't have it.
I had a question.
Sure.
Thank you for asking that question for me.
Sorry.
Okay. Any other questions? Or
yeah, questions? I had a quick question, and it sounds very innovative. So the instructional rounds, mm-hmm. if I'm understanding, so all the teachers say, like, in first grade, you're taking turns sitting in on each other's classroom?
That's correct. No administrators are present. It's teacher-led, and instructional coaches are there as well. So they go in with look-fors, what should be included to have a guided reading group with fidelity, and they're observing the teachers, and then they're having conversations about what went well and giving them tips and pointers. And so the teacher being observed learns a lot from the process, and the teachers observing learn a lot. So it's really been a very motivating process for Austin.
Thank you for your mm-hmm. information.
Sure.
Any other questions or discussion? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All opposed, like sign. Congratulations on your plans, and let us know how we can help, okay?
Thank you.
We're all behind you.
Thank you.
Dr. Stockton's District of Innovation and Public Hearing, sir.
Okay, this is a night of public hearings. I'll ask Dr. Knoll to come back to the podium. Dr. Knoll is going to present information and ask for the board to approve a resolution. And then upon the approval of the resolution, then we will go to public hearing and ask for comments. And then we're going to come back and ask the board to approve the committee that actually is going to put the plan together. Okay, so that's probably a little unusual. That's why I want to explain the process. At this time, I'll turn it over to Dr. Knoll.
Well, good evening once again. Excited to have this opportunity to share with you information about the District of Innovation opportunity that lies before us. Now, the 84th legislature passed House Bill 1842, and that created an option for districts to apply to become districts of innovation. What that means is that a district can design an innovation plan and would allow some flexibility on certain state statutes. It doesn't remove the need for us to follow all state statutes. There are certain criteria that allow us to have flexibilities in set areas. The overall thing that it does is it localizes or it maximizes local control, and it increases our local flexibility, and we believe that is a very positive thing. It gives you more authority to make approvals for items that we've previously been applying for waivers for, and you've always approved the waivers, but then after your approval of waivers, we've had to send those to the state and get the state's approval. Through this process, your approval is the final approval that would be needed, and so we can move maybe quicker and have more flexibility. So when we looked and tried to examine what areas of flexibility are available through the District of Innovation, and what you can see here is the items that are in black are areas that we currently have waivers on file. We have already applied, you've approved waivers in these areas, but what we've noticed is there are a few areas that we've not previously had opportunities in. The first you'll see there in red is early start date. The statute says that we cannot start school earlier than the fourth Monday in August. By becoming a District of Innovation, if we included that in our plan, we would have an opportunity or the option to start school earlier. So that would give us more flexibility with the calendar. Another area that we listed that could be included in our plan would be teacher certification for a CTE industry expert. And an example of that may be if we started a new CTE program, we were unable to find a certified teacher to teach that program, but we found someone that is credentialed and highly qualified in the field. If we wanted to hire them as a teacher, we would come to you to seek your approval of that. If we felt they were qualified and could do a good job, we would come to you and ask for your approval for them. A couple of notes about the plan itself is it can be changed at any time. We're not locked in or forced to do anything that's included in our plan. It simply gives you the authority to make those decisions, and we can have more local control in any decisions that were made. Like I said, we can change the plan at any point. There's the process that we're going through tonight. We would just repeat that process if ever the plan was to be changed to allow for public comment via the web, and then come back and ask you to approve a change. And we'll have to renew the plan every 5 years if we choose to move forward. As Dr. Stockton mentioned, the order of events is a little interesting with this one. But if you choose to proceed with investigating this District of Innovation, we would start tonight with a resolution and then a public hearing and appointment of a committee. The committee would then work on the plan itself. Once the plan was developed, we would post it online, allow the public to make comment. We would come back to you in December with the plan, with the public comment. We would ask for your approval of the plan at that time. So if there are any questions, I certainly, yes, ma'am.
I have a lot of questions.
Okay.
So there aren't that many districts in the state who've adopted the District of Innovation. So I'm wondering, what research have you done with those districts? For instance, Spring Branch, there's not a lot of large districts who have adopted it yet. So I'm kind of interested in, you know, what's their success? What's their public opinion? What were their process before they adopted District of Innovation for their district? Have you been following that at all?
Yes. So multiple districts are in the process. Humble has approved. When we think about the ones that are most like us and closest, Humble has theirs approved. Ours is very similar to theirs, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. Fort Bend is going through the process right now as well. The challenge, honestly, that we've had is that the state is not real forthcoming with information. Mm-hmm. It's hard to get information. And I think for that reason, you can see through the areas of flexibility that we've listed, we've been very conservative with what we would want to include. Mm-hmm. There are some districts that have more items on the list than what we would have, you know, different class size and really getting out there as far as teacher certification or teacher contracts and pay. Those are not areas that we would entertain. Mm-hmm. So really, we think by taking the conservative nature, you know, it will allow us to move slowly and not get far out where maybe a mistake could be made. Because I think we're all learning together.
Sure.
Exactly. And part of the impetus of moving forward now, to be honest with you, is the school start date involves the calendar process. And the calendar process is one that we have begun and will begin to move forward. And so if this is something that you all would entertain and would want us to pursue, it would need to be a part of the calendaring process for the next school year if we were going to utilize the school start date change.
But isn't And you can get back to your questions, but isn't it also that we no longer have a...
The waiver process? Yes, sir. That's one of the areas...
You have the 23rd kindergarten student,
correct,
you know, in the exception. You never, no longer have that waiver process.
Right. It's one of the areas that the state is very unclear with us. We've called multiple times, and sometimes they tell us the waiver process is completely gone. Sometimes they tell us that, oh, well, there still may be a way to do a waiver for that, but we don't know how that's going to work yet. So this is sort of us hedging our opportunities here to make sure that we can continue to operate the way that we have, based on a few of those waivers that we have out there.
And I think let me jump in just a second. I think the important thing to remember is the board would still approve these things.
Mm-hmm.
So we still go through a process. We don't want to miss the opportunity to have that option and lose out on waiver opportunity. Jessica, to answer your question, every day I read about a district. It's Clear Creek I was reading about today, and one of their, they were looking at start date, the 2021 waivers, and they have a lot of astronauts in their area that may not be certified, but they may be highly qualified to teach a certain subject. So they're looking at flexibility there. But we are monitoring that daily.
Yeah, because I mean, SciFair, for instance, has gone on record. You've talked to Dr. Henry, I'm sure, about this before. Yeah, they'll never adopt, he says, a district innovation plan. So I'm interested in why we're I'm kind of curious as to why we're thinking about doing it. I also have questions about who's going to be on that committee that makes those decisions. Is it an elected committee by the staff of the schools? Is it who gets on?
Our recommendation is going to be it's the district site, the district
planning,
district level planning and decision making committee. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but who's on that committee and how do they get on that committee?
They're elected. They're elected parents, community members, and teachers that are on that committee, and administrators.
They're appointed or elected?
They're elected. They have to be. Every campus submits names, and then they're elected.
Okay. I had a quick question.
Yes, sir.
And I can't cite the specific language, but looking at, I thought it was language of the bill, the legislature refers to, they make a reference to charter schools.
Yes.
And so my question is kind of big picture. What I don't know if you looked into the legislative intent. What is the purpose of this bill and the innovation? Have they came out and said, okay, this is the direction we're going? Is it to appease or is it?
Part of the language of the bill, as you said, it talks about allowing ISDs to operate with some of the flexibilities that charter schools are allowed to operate with. Now, that's very open-ended and could lead to people going really far.
Yeah.
That's not our nature, not what we would at all.
That's the second time, excuse me for interrupting, mm-hmm. That's the second time you said though really far. Are we talking about having like college courses where you have the entire auditorium at Conroe High School full of English 1 like you do at UT? I mean, would that be a really far out example?
It could be. Now, well, some of the language in the bill or what you're seeing some districts do as an option, for example, would be to not be held to the state minimum teacher salary. That's not at all something that we would advise be included in our plan.
I can't imagine that would be intentional, but could it be something that could be unintentionally enforced later in 5 years and 4 years and 3 years? Different board, different administration team.
Oh, yeah.
If we're a district of innovation at that point,
absolutely.
You know, we can't control that.
We can't control the legislature 5 years from now either, though.
Right. Any plan, like you say, I mean, certainly if a different board could push for any type of change in a plan.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever plan that was put forth now would be in place unless the board approved it to change. So there would be no changes. A change can't happen without board approval.
So I just want to make sure I understand. I'm sorry, do you have a question?
No, okay.
So I have a question about, can you back up two slides or three
Yes.
slides? Yes. Right there. So teacher certification. So obviously, we're going to get more information from you guys before mm-hmm. the date. I just want to be sure I understand what you're proposing or you're considering. Is that you would consider hiring teachers that are not certified teachers to teach our students if we go to a district of innovation plan?
Potentially.
It could be a possibility.
I mean, it's like, I think of you were teaching an accounting class, right?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, that's
perfect example.
A CPA. And I could just teach the accounting class based on y'all's criteria.
Well, not you.
Well, I'm
well, there's a lot more to teaching than subject matter knowledge.
Well, absolutely.
I think the example that we talked about at the workshop 2 weeks ago was if we had someone that had been teaching at Lone Star in a certain CTE, and this was specifically, we're looking at CTE industry experts. If they've been teaching at Lone Star, but they're not a certified public school teacher, having them teach one of our dual credit courses in that CTE field. I mean, obviously, I think we want someone that is proven themselves at capable of teaching. I'm not someone, even though accounting is something, you wouldn't want me teaching, you know, a bunch of kids. That would not be the best thing. So I think that's what we're looking at here.
I think it sounds good. I think it's a real slippery slope, and it opens up to possible future issues when different boards, different opinions, different agendas start to come into play. And the education community has been watching District of Innovation for 2 or 3 years now since it's been rumored and now is a reality. And I think there's a lot of reasons to still be considered this could to be considered a dangerous plan to adopt. So I just want to put that out there, and I think there's a lot of research out there that kind of shows that it can be positive, but it can also turn into a nightmare for school districts and teachers and communities. So
that's not a question, Jessica, just a point. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Other than self-government, I mean, the potential dangers of self-governing ourselves and these various criteria, mm-hmm. what other negatives do you perceive? Do you perceive out of this plan could arise?
Well, I mean, except for the calendar, the flexible calendar, the other three things that are listed here make me concerned. Mm-hmm. You know,
due to the self-governance aspect of it, as opposed to state issuing.
Yeah, I think there are rules in place for a reason. There are certain class size, for instance. There's a rule in place for class size for a reason. And applying for a waiver offers transparency. It offers, you know, you have to go through certain procedures to get a waiver right now, currently. And if you don't have to go through all that, what's to say we don't just?
What if that process is not there? That's what I understand. That's the fact. It's
well,
not
it
going to be there, the waiver process. So in other words, if it's 22-1 mm-hmm. and you don't have a place to file a waiver and you're not a district of innovation, you get to hire an extra kindergarten teacher whether you need it or not.
But there's 22-1 as research proves that students, we need smaller class sizes.
Okay.
So that's in place for a reason is what I'm saying here.
I absolutely understand that, but you understand that most districts file for waivers.
Yes, I understand that.
And
doesn't mean I agree with it.
Well, I mean on a limited basis, and they're sure. approved on a limited basis.
Sure.
But if that process is not there, then the exception is excluded. I mean, it is either 22-1 or you start over with another teacher. That's the part that concerns me. The early start date, I mean, you know, that, we could live with that if we had mm-hmm. to. But that lack of class waiver, mm-hmm. you know, class size waiver, if that process is truly dead with this bill, mm-hmm. I mean, I'm unclear whether you said
I am as well. Yes, sir. Just to be honest, I mean, we haven't gotten clear answers, and so
But as a general rule, I'm all for local control rather than, you know, a bunch of people that I don't know deciding when I should start school in Montgomery County or in Conroe ISD. And so as a general rule, I'm liking the local control. I think we can control our own business, but I not without seeing your point.
And I understand your point, too. It is attractive, but I think sometimes the attraction to things like that do have unintended consequences down the road, and I think we should be very cautious when we start walking that path.
I think one of the benefits of this plan, the way that it's written as far as any change to the plan would be that any change to the plan would initiate the exact same process that becoming a district of innovation in the future would be. So let's say it's not something that we sought forth today, and a board 4 years from now chose to become a district of innovation. They would go through the same plan mm-hmm. to change your current plan as they would just to become a district of innovation then. It's mm-hmm. the same process. So I don't know that this opens any door for a future board to create different policy, because they would still have to follow those exact same procedures as they would.
Do I have a question?
Yes.
If we voted for become a district of innovation, but yet then we or a future board sees some unintended consequences, as Jessica's pointing out, what is the process for going back.
Absolutely.
You're saying, so we don't want to be district of innovation.
You could basically just eliminate the plan. Mm-hmm. And by change the plan, you do the same process. You allow for public input in person. You allow online public input. And then you come back and you would vote. And you would just vote to change the plan and eliminate it. That's an option that you would have. And part of this process, what we would ask for today is a resolution allowing us to move forward in the process. Today is not asking to become a district of innovation. It's saying we're okay with you exploring that. And so the next step would be the formation of a plan, and we would get that feedback. And then we would provide that to you and give you plenty of time to work through the plan. And then we would come back to you in December to get your feelings and specific feedback on the plan at that point. And that's when we would be asking to truly get that designation. So today is simply asking to move forward with the investigation of having that distinction. And I agree, Ms. Powell, there's things we need to look at all aspects of it and make sure that we're not moving down a path that we don't. And that's part of this. I believe that's part of why it's built in the process of having time, so that it doesn't go too quickly and you have time to look at all aspects.
And don't forget, we would still come to the board for approval on these items.
Yes.
We typically approve. I think in a smaller district size, this would, as Jessica pointed out, will pose a serious concern for me. Mm-hmm. The larger district sizes we have, I don't think is of a concern, because I can fully understand Jessica's point. Mm-hmm. I mean, you get to the point where you're cutting corners and you want to increase class sizes, budget situations come into play, teacher certifications go out the window. Mm-hmm. But with this district of this size, I don't see it as being as pertinent. But I see the point.
Jessica, I thank you for your perspective. Mm-hmm. I thank you for what you brought to this discussion, because I think you bring a point of view that is very valuable to this. I agree. I'm all for the more local control, the better. And I do think that I hope that our teachers, there's not very many of you left in the audience, but that our educators will continue to, through this process, provide us with that feedback so that we can really look at this to the level that we need to. I really don't like legislators telling districts really what works statewide doesn't necessarily work in every district. I like districts being able to determine more what works for them and that local control. And so I really want that feedback from our district and from our community to tell us what they want and whether we go forward on this. But I'm all for looking at it and investigating it.
And an example of plans, just Ms. Powell, just so you'll know, like in our we've created some framework of a possible plan of different pieces that the committee may choose to put in. And for example, class size, it states very clearly in our plan, a class size, that we believe small class sizes are effective for student learning. Mm-hmm. It would be used for those situations where it's 23rd. February and the 23rd kid moves in and nobody wants to move, have their class split in February. We will line that out in the plan so that it won't be bullets like this in the plan that you're asked to approve. It will be much more specific and lined out exactly how that would be used. And for example, like minutes of instruction, you see that it would be lined out in the plan specifically, for on state testing days, so upperclassmen would have late arrival, which is what we do now. But that it's lined out specifically, so it just can't be however someone in the future may choose to interpret it. It's lined out specifically.
Thank you.
Very good. We need to approve the resolution. We need to vote on the resolution. Excuse me.
Motion to approve the resolution to become the innovative school district.
We would ask you to approve a resolution that would initiate the process of exploring and considering the designation as a district.
Thank you very much. Yes,
thank you, Mr. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion or questions? Good. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All opposed, like sign. Thank you very much.
Now okay, at this back. Time we're now in public hearing. So if anybody would like to come and make a comment, please come to the podium and state your name and make your comments.
Crickets again.
Seeing the audience look like we're at a high-level auction, we will move now to coming back to Dr. Knoll to ask for approval of the committee to develop.
As we move forward in the process, we would ask that you would approve the district-level planning and decision-making committee as our committee that will be charged with the development, discussion and development of our District of Innovation Plan. We do believe, as Dr. Stockton mentioned earlier, it's a very diverse group. It's made up of parents and educators and community members, and so we feel like they would offer all unique perspectives into the plan. So at this time, we would seek your approval as their designation as our committee to move forward.
I hear a motion.
Move to approve the DLPDMC committee as our District of Innovation committee.
And do I have a second? Motion and second. Any discussion? Questions? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. All opposed, like sign. Very much. Thank you, Dr. Knoll. Stockton?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. But I did just.
We do have.
I just want to reiterate our philosophy is not changing going into this process whatsoever. Thank you.
Very good.
Item 5A, update on attendance zoning process for Oak Ridge feeder schools. Dr. Stockton.
Okay, I'm going to invite Dr. Hines up to provide an overview of the process that we're just now beginning.
Good evening, President Husbands, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. It's a privilege to come up and give you a quick overview of this process for rezoning. As you know, very well know, that we're opening a new school next year. Lucille J. Bradley Elementary School will open. And that is going to be a school for about 1,000 students, and that is going to be located at 4200 Falls Lake Drive, and it's right there where it intersects with Guadalupe River Boulevard in Creekside. So we're going to be starting the process for working on the boundaries for that school. At the same time, we'll be looking at the boundaries for the students that will attend Flex 18. It's a school that is yet to be named. That is also a school being planned for 1,000 students, and that will open a year following. So that will open in the fall of 2018, and that school will serve grades 5 and 6. It's located at, or will be located at, what will be Woodson's Reserve Parkway and Trench Lane. And then also in 2018 is when we will open Grand Oaks High School at 4800 Riley Fuzzle, and that's going to accommodate roughly 3,000 to 3,100 students. It'll open as a 9-10, unless that's changed by you, current 7th and 8th graders, and it'll phase in until we're at capacity in 2020. So just a quick reminder of the locations, just kind of give you the big road moving through is Grand Parkway and Bradley. I'll just make an observation. It's very close to existing schools of Burnham Woods and Ann K. Snyder Elementary, as well as not too far from Kaufman. As you know, mm-hmm. Burnham Woods is close to Kaufman, and they all kind of run up and down Burnham Woods Drive or that corridor. So it's going to make for a unique boundary discussion, but we'll figure it out. And then Flex 18 is not very far away from Cox Intermediate, so that also will create some interesting discussion about how to draw those boundaries. And Grand Oak High School, of course, is a pretty good distance from Oak Ridge High School, and so that will not be probably as well. It will be difficult, but it won't be the same kind of discussion. It goes without saying why we need the schools. We continue to grow at a very fast rate. We're just under 60,000 students today. We have a lot of growth in this particular area, particularly in this part of the district. We also are having some growth in the Oak Ridge feeder up in the 242 corridor, which we hope to have a campus up there in this bond issue as well. So there will be some hopefully another campus that's added to that location. So we do have.
And they're zoned where right now? May I interrupt you? Excuse me.
That area is split between Oak Ridge Elementary and Hauser Elementary. And Vogel Intermediate. Just a quick reminder, these are some of the images that have been out that you probably have seen. That's the rendering of Grand Oaks High School, the site layout, where it stands on the Grand Parkway. And You'll see in a little bit some of the pictures of the steel that's already going up on that site. That's kind of that rendering of the faraway view. There's no grass there yet. We have Lucille J. Bradley Elementary School, another rendering, and you'll see some pictures in a minute of it at its steel format. That's the layout, and that's Guadalupe River Boulevard, and it runs into Falls Lake, which is Falls Lake runs back to Burnham Woods Drive. And just a couple of pictures, and again, I won't get into the presentation on the update of the bond, so I'll speed through those. Flex 18 Intermediate, that's a rendering of that campus. And to do this process, we have a committee. We actually have two parts to our committee. The first part of the group, it's a little smaller. It focuses mostly on the campuses that are in the impacted area or near the impacted area. And so we have representatives from Burnham Wood, Broadway, Cox, Ford, Kaufman, Snyder, Vogel, and as well as central administration representation. And we'll work on both the elementary and Flex 18. One of the things that, as we've started to prepare, that it's become obvious that it's really hard to do one without the other. Mm-hmm. So if we know where the students are at elementary, it might help the discussion about where we draw the lines for the intermediate. So we combine those two. And then the high school, it's a larger committee. It encompasses really the whole feeder system, representation from the entire feeder zone. So that's those are the members. We have several goals. I won't read them all to you, but we certainly understand that this is an important process. Whenever you change where people go to school, it impacts their lives and it impacts their routine. So we try to do it in the way that impacts people the least. We always try to keep people informed. We are trying to achieve an objective of putting students in new schools, as well as kind of positioning ourselves for a few years so we don't have to just keep doing this every year. And so we have a pretty good record of once we get people in the schools, we try to leave them there for at least a period of time. Even though some of these fast areas where we've grown very quickly, it's been difficult.
Let me ask you if what you mean by that is you may start out with a lower number of students. Let's just say two schools have 1,000 capacity, and one of them has 800 and one of them has 600. But you see that growth making the other one, they're both increasing, so the 8 goes to 1,000, but the 6 goes towards 1,000 faster. So you're planning for that ahead of time. Is that what I hear you say?
Yes, we try to take all that into consideration, the rate of growth. And a lot of that's based on, again, projections, and things change. Sometimes it happens faster, sometimes it happens slower. But we do have pretty good data. We use the demographic studies that have been done for our district to kind of plan out. We look at the current patterns, and we study it over time. And so we really try to position ourselves. And again, with the fast growth, particularly in that area, we know that we're not finished, that there'll be more growth in the future. So that's why our goal isn't necessarily to be done. It's to be done for a while, because we know we'll have to come back and look at it soon enough, because we can just keep growing. We'll have to add some more schools. We do take into consideration several things. I mean, one of them is the capacity of campuses. Some of our older campuses are smaller than some of the newer ones. We take in input. We look at demographic factors, feeder patterns, geographical proximity. One of the things we always do, and I'll show you in a minute, when we do the zones, we make a map so we can see what does it look like? Does it make sense? Or are we driving through one neighborhood to get to another school and take crisscrossing each other? So we try to look at those kind of things. We look at projected future enrollment. We look at transportation patterns and other natural boundaries. And so we look at all those things, and sometimes they compete and sometimes they contradict. We also try to go out and give information. We'll start this week. Actually, tomorrow night we have our first one. We'll present information. The first three times, it's the same information presented three times. We will just present the process the first go around. Then our committee will be working on developing scenarios. In the second, or what is the community forum number one, we'll come back and present the scenarios. We'll actually put together some recommendations. We'll bring them out. We'll let people see them, get feedback. We'll go back, tweak, work on them, try to come up with what we think is the best plan that we recommend as a group. Hopefully we'll recommend it as an entire group, but from my experience, sometimes with a large committee, we don't all agree. And some, so we usually go, we will go with the majority voice as a recommendation. So, but we try to get everybody to agree, but sometimes folks don't agree, and it's okay. So we'll vote at the end and make a recommendation. Our hope is to bring you a recommendation at the January board meeting. And after that first set of forms, when we develop our recommendations, we come back around and we show folks, this is what we came up with, this is what we want to recommend, and we give people a chance to see it before we bring it back for your approval. And then we'll bring in and make a recommendation in January. So that's kind of the timeline, just so you can kind of see how that flows. And then once that decision is made, we'll start working on the process of figuring out who's going to go to Bradley Elementary, and that will start another process with HR and some other things that go on. So we will begin that.
I had a quick question.
Yes.
I want to applaud you on communication with all the forums and then coming back again, just so we can be prepared to answer questions. How are those forums communicated?
We sent out a letter, and then one of the areas that we also try to accomplish through this process is to make the ability for people to give us feedback even if they cannot attend the forum. So everything that we present or talk about is on our website, and right now on our main page, if you just kind of scroll down a little bit, you get to a part that talks about the attendance boundary process. When you click on the learn more, it takes you to a page dedicated strictly to this process where it talks about what we do and why we're doing it and what schools are going to open. We also have some documents that are loaded on here that people may find helpful, such as the goals, the considerations. We have planning documents that includes the current maps of how the feeder zones are. And I'll click on, for example, this is the intermediate feeder map in the Conroe and in the Oak Ridge zone. So you can kind of see how and these little areas you see with the letters and the numbers, those are planning zone increments. Those are what we use for the purpose of moving around to create populations.
And so what I hear you saying, in addition to the website information, that every parent that's affected will receive a letter about these forms?
Yes, we send home to everybody, and we include everybody in the Oak Ridge feeder.
Okay.
So
not just parents.
The parents and the families that are in the Oak Ridge feeder from kindergarten through 12th grade.
Right. Okay.
We also have the demographic study, which is of course that long document. The schedule of the community forums, the timelines, the high growth areas, and the planning zones. And then in addition, we have some other documents that people may find helpful. These three pages have been made for places where we can receive feedback. And we've already started receiving feedback, so I know people are finding this information. Every day we'll get an email from somebody. This is an example of what it looks like. When you open it up, it talks about there's three different documents that are here. The first one is the current feeder map that we just showed you an example of the intermediate. I'll show you this one is the elementary. And these are the elementary schools, how they're divided. So Burnham Woods is in the green. Kaufman is in that pink color. Broadway is down here in that kind of a tan, and then Snyder's in the yellow. That just gives you an idea.
Where is Bradley in 57? Can you go back
to that? Bradley is
57B.
Bradley is going to be
right in the green.
Right in the what is now in right. Burnham Woods attendance area.
Okay.
So right on the edge of 57B in the 57M. Mm-hmm. So that's where the physical location of that campus is. And then, let me go back. We also include what is on the map, but in a written form. And it's color-coded by the colors on the map, so that if you wanted to match up the school with the numbers, you can kind of figure out. So this is an example of, and I always have to point out, we share this with the committee, that we have two different numbers. One is the number of students that live in the attendance zone, and one is the number of students at the school. And the reason we share that is because we do not include pre-K in our planning numbers. It's a program that isn't at every campus. In addition, there may be transfer students because teachers bring their children to their school, as well as there may be special programs. Not every school is bilingual. Not every school has life skills or other special programs. So those can impact enrollment. And you can see there's no one in the Bradley assigned area yet. And this gives you other schools. But these will be the four campuses that are mostly impacted on the first page. So that's information that's available. And then finally, I won't take you through it, but there's a worksheet. All that information I just showed you is in an Excel. So if people want to move it around, they can download the Excel file and it'll add it for them. So they can kind of see how many students am I putting in. Oh, I overfilled it or I took too many out of this school. So we try to put some tools to help people look at it and come up with some ideas. We've received four or five already proposed boundaries. So we've looked at them.
Dr. Hines, I want to thank you. I have an employee that works for me that is in this area and that is potentially impacted by this. And we downloaded the spreadsheet and had a lot of fun playing with it. So I thank you for all the incredible information. She was very impressed and, you know, doesn't have kids even in school yet, but she really was excited about the information and looking at it in detail. So thank you.
And we hope that, you know, everyone, again, whether they can attend the meeting or not, the idea is that everything that we present will be here. We'll put the PowerPoint, we'll put different information, and then if folks can attend, hopefully they can still look at it and see. And when we have our scenarios up there, there'll be opportunity. There is a feedback form on each of the pages, and people can, you know, submit feedback and say, I don't like this, I like this one, or I don't like this. One of the things that I've learned from experience is that we often hear from people that don't like it. We don't always hear from the people that do like something. So there's often silence associated with that. So it can get misleading, you know. A lot of people may like it, but they didn't say anything.
How are we, I know we have it on our website, and that's perfectly acceptable, and it looks beautiful, looks very well done. But we did have some feedback from the community about the naming of the school, about them not knowing where things were and all that good stuff. How else are we publicizing this particular process?
Is this, right now, our main push has been through our schools. So they've sent it out through their newsletters and sent home in the folders and get out the information.
But I'm sure with the media here tonight, this will be, you know.
we'll get some air time.
Thank you.
Anyway, process will begin, and
thank you,
we'll share
Hines.
Information. Thank you. Any other questions?
No, thank you.
Item 5B, capital approvals update. Dr. Stockton.
That's Danny Phillips, our assistant director of planning construction, to come up and make the presentation.
Oh. Mr. Phillips.
Good evening, President Husbands, members of the board, Dr. Stockton. It's my pleasure to bring you the update on the capital improvements projects within the district. Grand Oaks High School is our first facility. Grand Oaks High School is on schedule and set to open August 2018. This is our structural steel going up, making good progress. That's the academic wing. This is the view of the site paving, the athletics wings. This is a view of the auditorium paving seating area. This is a view going north, looking at Grand Parkway 99. Safety and security. This is one of our safety and security vestibules. Move along. Great. Looking at phase two starting in January 2017. Grangerland Intermediate Addition. This is a view of the addition, the classroom addition on the northwest back corner.
Danny.
Yes, sir.
Those safety vestibules.
Yes, sir.
Are we revising those and modifying those are we just sticking to one format or one plan? Because, I mean, I was at Powell trying to get in that thing, and yeah, and it's awkward. It's almost like I'm in some sort of correctional institution, and they try, and I'm trying to talk to the lady, and she can't get over there.
We are currently revising those front windows. They will be elevated to the 7 foot dimension versus the 6 foot five or whatever it is. It is awkward.
It's very awkward.
It's unfortunate. It didn't get installed as it should have. But the three facilities that it's lacking, it is ordered, and I believe it's coming in this week.
Okay.
So,
making sure we're making correct.
Yes, sir.
Speaking of that plan.
Yes, sir.
That plan didn't work. I was wrong on it. I got to tell somebody about this. Okay. All right. Good.
Grangerland Edition. This is the exterior. The facility is going great. We're scheduled to open it up January of 17. No issues. This is the interior. The mechanical systems are ongoing, moving great. Lucille J. Bradley, the new elementary, is on schedule to open up August of 17. This is your the structural steel. It's going absolutely wonderful. This is the CMU masonry over at the Fine Arts Wing. This is the MEP, the mechanical electrical plumbing systems, going in great.
Just real quick, yes. I was over in that area just last week and made a point of driving by, trying to find it. I was impressed so much by what y'all have done. It's absolutely incredible. What you do in a short amount of time is just amazing to me.
Thank you. So. Appreciate it. The Woodlands College Park Robotics Edition. This is the actual renovation, the demo being completed, the subgrade being compacted. It's on schedule to be opened up in spring break of 17. This is the structural steel that's on site waiting to be installed. It's on schedule, as I said. That's it for the updates.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Phillips.
Yes.
Appreciate it. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Comments?
No, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Item 6A, financial reports, Dr. Stock.
I'll ask Mr. Rice to come back to the podium and present the financials.
All right. Good evening, President Husbands, members of the board, and Dr. Stockton. It is my pleasure to present the financial statements for the month of September. Not a lot of transactions happening yet since we're just 1 month into our fiscal year, but we will start with the balance sheet for the district. Now, these financials will include our general fund, debt service, child nutrition, and self-funded insurance. We always like to look at our cash and investments and make sure our money's working for us. Looking at our cash and investments, we'll concentrate here on the general fund. We have cash on hand of $13,300. We have bank deposits of $80,000. We have investments in the pools of almost $97 million. Other investments, these are shorter term investments, a year or less, about $15.5 million. And in our longer term investments with TCG Investment Advisors, $50,860,000. For total cash investments of $162.8 million. Nothing to report on property taxes. We have not started collecting them yet.
So. I got my bill.
You got the bill.
Yeah,
bill.
Y'all have a great year.
Great Thursday morning. I'm going to give her a piece of money.
Tax rate's low.
Yeah, I got you.
See, appraisal district.
That's right. The next statement we'll look at is our income statement. The income statement includes our revenues and expenditures, and I said before, not very many transactions flowing through here yet. Looking at the revenues at the local sources, you can see the property taxes that we've collected are delinquent and penalties and interest so far that's come in. We can also look at our expenditures by major object. Once again, in the general fund, payroll is our largest expenditure. Okay, our 2015 bond referendum status for the month. We've currently expended and encumbered $212 million. Mm-hmm. We have an estimate to complete of $304 million. That gives us a project forecast of about $516 million to complete. That leaves us with a little over $4 million in our contingency. Self-funded insurance, first month into the new plan year, we had total revenues of $3,660,000.
We had total expenses of $3,618,000, leaving us with revenues over expenses of roughly $42,000. This is, you know, the new plan design. Mm-hmm. We're still having some runoff from the old plan from the previous month, so you see it a little bit higher. But looking at it so far this month, we're trending very well. So we're starting to see some of that plan design come into effect. And I'm hoping that the reports look better. We know how medical expenses always seem to escalate, but we feel pretty confident with that.
Well, any further on the Conroe Center?
On the north, we're in communication with them. We're actually having a meeting, a conference call Monday morning.
Okay.
And we're working on that progress.
Okay.
Okay, looking at our investments for the month of September, we had the par value of $299 million. The WAM of our pools is one day. They're yielding almost 70 basis points. As you can see, the pools are starting to build in that next Fed app. So you can see that starting to move throughout our investments. WAM of our other investments is 189 days. They're yielding over 1%. This is only $15 million. There's just a handful of investments in here, but we were able to find some very good investments. So we're actually yielding over 1% in there. Now, our longer-term investments that are invested with TCG Investment Advisors, that WAM is 597 days, and we're yielding just over 1%.
There's a little kink in the yield curve right now.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
The short is higher.
Yes.
We'll stay that way.
The WAM of our combined portfolio is 103 days, and we're yielding almost 77 basis points. And our benchmark, the 90-day T-bill, is 0.275, so still trending well against that. And that is it. Any questions?
Thank you, Darren.
Thank you.
All right. Closed session of the board will now be held on matters contained in the notice of this meeting as authorized by Section 551.074 of the Texas Open Meetings Act. Should the board determine that any final action, final decision, or final vote be required with regard to any matter considered in such closed or executive meeting or session, then such final action, final decision, or final vote shall be at either a public meeting upon reconvening of this public meeting, or at a subsequent public meeting of the board upon notice thereof, as the board shall determine. Closed session of the board will now be held. It is 7:45. Okay, we're back in session at 8:20, and we did formally complete the superintendent's evaluation, and just make that announcement. Do we need to adopt?
We need
one item is.
In your packet, you see information about revisions we're suggesting to local board policy BBB, just updating it. It's been almost 10 years since it's been updated.
Better Business Bureau.
No. Not approval this time. It'll be in.
Thank you for that revision, or thank you for those reviews. And I would
just not a motion
to.
That's
no, it's item. Information only.
It's information only.
Any questions, Ms. Glass? I'm sorry.
Motion to adjourn.
Seconded.
Second.
Motion. Got a second.